Good morning. For those of you that are joining us from home or maybe joining us later today, we welcome you to our service as we welcome those who are here. We've had a little bit of a glitch this morning with the internet. That's why for those of you who are at home, you might have been waiting a little longer and thought, well, Lynn's late again. Well, actually, for once, it was not Lynn's fault. So anyway, welcome to our worship service this morning. So if you'll stand, we're going to sing Standing on the Promises for our call to worship.
Welcome all of you that are worshiping with us today at Bethlehem Baptist Church. And we are resting and standing on the promises, aren't we? I think of what Peter says, that we have precious and magnificent promises. And Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. So we are grateful that you can join us today as we worship the Lord. Let's bow for prayer. Father, we thank you for your precious and magnificent promises, for your eternal word that's settled forever in heaven. And Lord, as we gather now, our heart's desire is that we would glorify you, that we would magnify your name as we worship you together, as we sing praises, as we bow in prayer, as we hear your word. May you be magnified and exalted in this service, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
As we left our live feed last week, we were in the process of going into our church conference and a time of discussion and a vote. And I wanted you guys at home to know, if you haven't heard, we voted unanimously to hire Austin Nally as our children and youth minister. At this time, we'll have him come up, and he's going to say a few words, and so you can meet him again. So. Good morning, Austin.
Well, I would just want to say thank you for how welcoming you've been. We're excited to be a part of Bethlehem. We're excited for what the future holds here. I do want to give a huge thank you to Ray and the rest of the personnel committee. A year and a half is a long time to be searching. So can we give a hand for them? That is definitely dedication to the Lord, dedication to the church. I do have a couple announcements. We're going to plan right now to have, I would like to meet with the youth and their parents on October 21st. That's a Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. It will not go past 6:45, 7 o'clock. We're going to be in the CAC. I'll have the table spread out. Please try to sit with families. I'm going to leave that up to your discretion. If you've been hanging out with another family and you want to sit together, you know, but I'm going to have it the opportunity for you to be spread out on the tables. And I'll have some probably sheets on the tables for some information from the youth, just so I can get to know you a little bit more. And we'll just, you know, just to kind of, so you guys get to know me and my wife and little Titus over there, who's just now waking up. So hopefully he stays calm. And then the following Wednesday, October 28th, I would like to meet with children and their parents. I would like to do the same thing of getting to know you guys better, and just so you can get to know me better. And we have some other things that are in the works. You know, things are kind of limited right now with the virus, but we're going to do what we can with what we have. So, but again, thank you for having us, and we're excited.
Thank you, Austin. We are so excited you're here. Isn't God good? Answer our prayers. And again, I want to back up the slide one more time, if you don't mind. I want Ray again to stand. If you were on that team, stand if you're here. We are so very grateful for all your work and prayers over the years. Let's give a big thanks to our search team, and particularly to Ray Graham. You have served faithfully. Thank you so much, search team, and especially Ray for leading them. As I told our sanctuary worshipers here today, we're going to start having the offertory plates passed in our service, or at least the ushers will bring them down. They'll do so after our prayer. I want to encourage all of you at home to continue to give as you have been so faithfully by bringing your offerings to the church office, mailing them in. You can give online very easily, and we encourage you to do that. And we'll also have our chest or a giving box in the back, but we want to begin this practice today as we slowly and safely begin to move back to some practices we've had in the years past. So let's bow for prayer now. Father, we thank you for bringing Austin and Amanda and little Titus to us. Lord, we pray that together you might work through us to build your church here. Lord, we thank you for the gift of your dear son, and we pray now as we give that we would express our heart's gratitude to you for your blessed son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand and join me as we sing our doxology? And it went away. Romans 3, 23 and 24 says, "For everyone has sinned, we all fall short of God's glorious standard. Yet God, in his grace, freely makes us right in his sight. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty for our sins." Our medley today is "Grace Greater Than Our Sin" and "Amazing Grace." Join us as we sing, please.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ebron. He can sing now, can't he? Sing for the Lord. We're so very, very grateful. Thank you so much. Quick announcement. Our deacons had a great meeting this morning. There's one item that our chairman wishes to bring back up to our deacons or to discuss. If you guys will meet over to my right after the service, we will appreciate it, and Jerry will have you there for just a short time. So last Sunday, we heard the challenge, Rise Up, Old Bethlehem Baptist Church, and we talked about evangelizing the sinner, equipping the saints, and exalting the Savior. Well, today I want us to hear, or this Sunday, to hear this challenge, which is very similar. It is, OBBC, or Bethlehem Baptist Church, fulfill the Great Commission. Fulfill the Great Commission. Now, this challenge to fulfill the Great Commission and to rise up, they're really connected. I want you to take a look at this very first page of our Constitution and bylaws, Article Number 2, just follow along as I read it, Section 1, Great Commission, it says, the purpose of this church is to fulfill the Great Commission as stated by Jesus Christ in Matthew 28, 19 and 20, by exalting Jesus, equipping the saints to do his work, and by evangelizing the sinners. See the connection. And so today, building on this challenge to rise up, I want us to hear this challenge, another challenge to fulfill the Great Commission. And they are connected. So let me ask you a question, congregation. What is the Great Commission? What is this purpose statement in our bylaws? What does it really mean when we say fulfill the Great Commission as stated by Jesus Christ? Well, I hope you have your Bibles. I invite you to open them. And if your Bible is similar to mine, as you turn to Matthew chapter 28 and verse 16, in my Bible, there's actually a subtitle that says the Great Commission. And I want to invite you to stand, whether you're at home or here, and let's read along, or you follow along as I read these verses, beginning in verse 16. And then we'll go through verses 19 and 20, which are the Great Commission. And then I will lead us in prayer. Listen now to God's word, beginning in Matthew chapter 28, verse 16. But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to which Jesus had designated. They saw him, they worshipped him, but some were doubtful. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Let's bow for prayer. Father, how we thank you for these words of your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, how we praise you that you gave him all authority in heaven and on earth, that we could carry out this commission. And we thank you, Father, now for this opportunity to hear anew and afresh the commission to us as your church here at Bethlehem Baptist Church. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you. You may be seated, and I hope you at home will have your Bibles open as we consider this Great Commission. And if you were to summarize or the essence of the Great Commission in just a few words, it is simply this: to make disciples of all the nations. That's the main point Jesus is charging his disciples to do, and us as well, to make disciples of all the nations. And let's just put it closer to home. We need to begin by making disciples of those in our community, right? Those that are here. And of course, we need to become disciples ourselves. So that this is a commission that affects all of us in this church and those in our communities. We seek to reach them. Let's talk about that charge or that commission today. And it reminds me of a book I read several years ago by Leroy Imes. It says, the title of it is Disciples Are Made, Not Born. And you know, Jesus did say, make disciples, right? That helps us realize that we don't come into the Christian life with instant discipleship. We don't become Christians and instantly have it all down and have it, you know, we know just how to live the Christian life. No, we are becoming. We are maturing. We are growing. And really the word disciple, in one other word, means learner. So Steve Taylor, as a disciple of Jesus, is a learner of Jesus Christ. The word can mean pupil or student. And so you, as a disciple of Jesus, you are a pupil of Jesus. You're learning how to live life the way he wants you to and the way he wants me to as his followers. So what are the main actions in this commission that Jesus gives us that we seek to fulfill as a church? There's really two main action words that I want to touch on this morning, but I want us to underscore the fact that we are all learners, right? Would you raise your hand and say you're a learner today of Jesus Christ? We all are. We're all in his classroom, so to speak. And so let's see two main actions. One main action in making disciples is baptizing. Look back in the text or read it on the screen there. Why don't you read it with me? Let's read verse 19 together. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And so here's that first action, and that is baptizing. All right, baptizing. Now, we are not baptized to be saved. You know, Sebring sang a song, fits right in, about going down to the river. I thought about Lydia and her ladies that went down to the river for a prayer meeting. But as they were there, Paul preached the gospel to them, and the scriptures say that the Lord opened Lydia's heart to respond to the things spoken by Paul. And so we're not saved by going into the water of baptism. We're saved, as we sang so beautifully today, by the grace of God. We're saved by the gift of life through Jesus Christ. We're saved by that marvelous, infinite, matchless grace that's greater than our sin. We're saved by that amazing grace shown through the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, through the love of God to send His Son to die for us. And aren't you grateful? Aren't you grateful that we are saved by the grace of God? We're saved through faith as we believe in Jesus Christ and believe that He died on the cross and was raised from the grave for us. Jesus is the one who saves us by His blood. And yet Jesus here says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Jesus is saying that when someone's heard the message of the gospel, then the immediate response is to be baptized. We have a great example of that in the story of Philip going to preach the gospel to the Ethiopian eunuch. And you recall the story. He goes there. He gets up in the chariot. He begins to explain Isaiah 53, where the eunuch is reading. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, you know, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter. He didn't open his mouth. And the Ethiopian eunuch was wondering, what does this mean? And I love how Luke describes what Philip did. Luke says, and beginning from this scripture, he preached Jesus to him. Wow, you know, and then what happened? The Ethiopian eunuch responded, believed. And then he says, look, here's some water. What prevents me from being baptized? And Philip says, if you believe, you can. So at that moment, at that place, Philip baptized, got in the water with the Ethiopian eunuch and baptized him by immersion in the water completely. That's what baptism means, to immerse. And that's what we practice here. So understand that baptism doesn't save us, but it does show our belief in Jesus Christ, right? It shows that we believe in Him, that we're on the road to following Him. It signifies the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so we have that familiar expression when you hear a minister baptize someone. Usually you'll say, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That marvelous Trinitarian formula, that proof that our one God shows Himself in three persons. And then he may say something like this, which I normally do. Buried with Him in the likeness of His death. Help me out. Some of you know this. And risen to walk in newness of life. In other words, by that act of water baptism, we signify this marvelous salvation where we literally are united with and identified with Jesus Christ in His death, in His burial, and then in His new life. As He was raised from the grave, so are we as well. And so that's what baptism signifies. And Jesus says, you go make disciples. You share the gospel with them and then baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We have lots of grand memories of baptisms here in the church, do we not? I saw one a couple of months ago. I think I was maybe with Susie Owens, maybe with Amy Doolin at a meeting. We just have a few meetings around here that I get to go to. And I was at one of those, and Susie and Amy, I think they whipped out their phones, and they said, look at this picture that Wayne sent us. I've got a picture of it here. I think this is precious, all right? That's from 8 years ago, all right, on July 12, 2012, all right? And so here we have Wayne, this is upstairs. For those of you who may not be familiar with where this is, before the baptism took place, he has Austin Brown, Sam Goins, and Bailey Doolin. Isn't that precious? What a great day of celebration. What a time where they look back, and we, as we look at our baptism, it marks our public confession and profession of our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, our following of Him. And I think maybe Bailey and Jessica for sure are watching today with Mama. And so on behalf of the congregation, I want to say to Bailey, congratulations on this special remembrance, and also to Jessica and Amy that are watching. And maybe, is Sam here? Sam's here. All right, congratulations, Sam. And we love Austin and his family. Congratulations to Austin as well. Isn't the time of your baptism a special marker at the beginning, typically, of your following of Jesus Christ? And so I look forward to the days ahead when we will share Jesus with those around us, whether it's through VBS, through our personal conversations with them, or other evangelistic events we'll begin to have here at the church, and we see others in our community come to faith in Jesus Christ. Don't you look forward to that day? Pray for that day. I look forward to the time when we will see more baptized, when we fill up our baptismal pool and we see them baptized. Look forward to the day when we are able to number and increase in the disciples of Jesus Christ in this fellowship. Can I get an amen? That's what we all are for. And of course, we're very grateful to have Austin and his dear wife and little Titus with us to help us as we seek to share the gospel and continue this action of baptizing. So that's one main action of making disciples of all the nations, baptizing. What's the other in the text? Look back in your Bible, or let's just read it on the screen, all right? The next action, or the main action that Jesus gives, is teaching. Read with me verse 20. Teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So the first action Jesus commissions us with is baptizing. Then the other action he gives us is teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. Let's highlight that all that I commanded you first. Our responsibility as disciples of Jesus, and as those who are making disciples of others, is to teach them all the words of Jesus and also all the words of Scripture. All right, we are to teach them all that Jesus has said, and that's found in the Gospels, right? What are the four Gospels? Help me out. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Often the letters of Jesus are in red. All those words of Jesus, all that he commanded, are to be taught. But also the epistles and the rest of the New Testament, which are what the apostles wrote down as Jesus, by the Holy Spirit, continued to teach them other things. He actually said that before he left. He said, I have other things which I will teach you. And so those teachings we have. And of course, the prophets in the Old Testament, they point to Jesus Christ. And Jesus himself said at one time that, you know, the sum of all the law and the prophets is in the words, love your neighbor as yourself, do unto others as you would have them to do unto you. So really, we have the whole of the Scriptures that we are to learn as disciples of Jesus Christ. We are to learn all the Scriptures. We are to teach all the Scriptures. And as I emphasized last week, we do so as a church through our Sunday school time. And hopefully we'll be able to start that soon. We do that through our Bible study times on Sunday afternoons. We do that as we personally hear sermons, as we read Scriptures. And I want to encourage all of us as learners and followers of Jesus Christ to stay in the Word of God, to keep hearing the Word of God, to keep being involved in Bible studies and groups where you learn the Word of God, to keep reading the Scriptures. I talked to Pat Hernan this week, and she fondly remembers going to visit shut-ins, and she especially mentioned Louise Maples. And Pat said, you know, Louise Maples was such a smart woman, and she knew her Bible. And then Pat went on to say, I'll never forget what she would tell us. She says, when you read your Bible, don't miss a word. Read all the these and all the thous. Don't miss any of the words. And Louise was so right. You know, we grow in discipleship as we hang on and learn all the words of Scripture. All the words. If you look in the book of Matthew, I was thinking about the teachings of Jesus just in the book of Matthew. And if you look at that, there are several segments of teaching. Jesus starts off teaching about how to enter and how to live in the kingdom of God, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. In chapter 10, he talks about how to go on mission for him and how to share Jesus Christ. In Matthew 13, he talks about the parables and how to understand what it is to be part of the kingdom. In Matthew 18, he talks particularly about forgiving others. And then Matthew 24 and 25 about being ready for his coming. All those were teachings of Jesus. And we need over the years to take in all of that teaching so that we can become and continue to be learners of Jesus. So we teach all is our commission. But also notice that word, teach them to observe. In other words, it's not enough to take it up in up here. We need to work out the word of God in our lives with what we do. So we need to teach others to do the word of God, to not only hear. So Jesus himself said, man shall not live on bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And a later place he says, my mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it. So we are called to act on the word of God, to apply it in our lives. And that's a lifelong process. And we're all familiar with that. When you went to the job where you are now or were, no doubt you were trained, right? You had a period of training. Talked to Helen McDaniel this week, and she remembered the training she received at the Shelby School. I'm going to call it School of Nursing, but when she was in the nursing school, they actually had a nurse's home. How many of you know, remember that? It wasn't a nursing home like we call them today. It was a nurse's home, and she said that she and bless her heart, Miss Mildred Dixon and Ruth Yarbrough, to just name three. They lived on that campus near, it's kind of where the old health building is now, I think. It's been torn down. But they lived there, and the doctors came in and trained them and taught them so they would become excellent nurses. And she said that nurses came from all over the state because that was a premier teaching hospital at that time where they trained nurses. You know, Jesus himself said, a disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone after he's been fully trained will be like his teacher. So my direction as a follower of Jesus is to become like Jesus Christ, right? Isn't that yours? To be like him, to be fully trained in his character, in his truth, to know the truth of God and to live it out in our lives. That's what we're called to do. But it's a lifelong process. And so I was thinking about that in the last few when Tois and I would go see little baby, right? And so I began to realize, you know, you start learning real early. And how is it that you learn to language, for instance? How is it that you learn papa or mama or daddy, or in my case, pop-pop, okay? So I want to show you this, or at least play it for you. I don't think we can get it up on the screen, can we? He's going to try. We got a couple quick little videos here. If he can't, preacher's going to play it right here, at least so you can hear it. Let's see if we can do it. They're going to try. They do a great job up there, and we're so grateful for all they do. See if they can get it. If they can't, preacher's just going to use what he's got right here. What you think? Is it going to work? That's okay. I got it right here, and what I'm going to do, let's try this.
Say, I love Elmo. Tell, look at Pop Pops and tell Pop Pops.
Say, let's hear it.
Pop Pop.
Pop Pop. Pop Pop.
Can you tell him you love Elmo? Say, tell him Elmo.
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 That's pretty close, huh? All right, now I got one more. All right. That was. Oh, he's got it. You got it. You got it. Oh, back there. Excuse me. Okay, go ahead. We're going to get it. Well, she's waving at us. All right, we're trying, aren't we? We're trying. But I tell you, let me play it again. I'll play the second one. So, Pop Pop, she got that down. You want to hear it again, don't you?
Pop Pops and tell Pop Pops.
Say, let's hear it.
Bye, bye. Pop Pop.
Pop Pop.
Bye, bye. Bye, bye. Can you tell him you love Elmo? Tell him Elmo.
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 That's pretty good, isn't it? She loves Elmo. Okay, she loves Elmo. Here's the one last shot with the Elmo. Here, let's see. Well, here it is. But don't you love technology? Here we go. What did the preacher do today? Well, he sat there and played with his phone. Let's see if I can get this to work. You want to hear this. If it'll come on. Let's see, I'm having troubles too. Oh, here it is.
Say Elmo.
Yes, you know. So, okay. Thank you for indulging me, but it does make the point, right? You learn early. How did she learn? She heard someone else say the word, pop, pop, bye-bye, Elmo. How do we learn to follow Jesus? We hear others speak the truth of about Jesus and his word. We see others live it out, right? And I thought about that. How did I begin to learn how to maybe go visit someone in a hospital home? I saw my grandpa do that, and I went with him. So, how did I learn how to respect others and prize them when I talked to them? I saw the gleam in Dr. Gaddy's eyes as he visited with fellow parishioners, people in the church. And I thought, you know, you got to love people and show them respect. You know, how did I learn to reach out to people, whatever their background or race or education experience? I saw John Beam in the inner city of Savannah reach out to a person and love them no matter who they were, you see. How did I learn to put some organization to comments? I saw and heard Dr. Bryson talk about that and do that. See, we learn from others, do we not? You just take a moment and thank God for someone in your life that you learn from. See? And they're coming to your mind, are they not? These teachers, these parents, these grandparents that you learn from. He'll be saying pop, pop pretty soon. Or nobody's going to call you daddy, right? Yeah. Hopefully so. All right. There you go. Dad. We'll wait for the day. We'll have to hear that when it happens. The things you've learned and heard and seen and received in me, Paul said, practice these things and the God of peace will be with you. So you see, that's how we become disciples. We see it lived out with one another. And that's why it's so important that we're together and we're able to worship together and minister together. Because that's how we grow in becoming disciples of Jesus Christ. So teaching them all and then teaching them to observe or to do. And as I think about that, I think of a man named Matthew Henry. Got a picture of him. How many of you have ever heard of Matthew Henry's commentary? Many of you have. Many of you use it over years. What I have here on the screen is, it's what a commentary with biblical teaching and practical application. It's been used for over 300 years. It's a great commentary. And he's so incisive with his explanation and clear with his application. And we got a couple guys in the church that especially like him, teacher Bob Byers. And I gave Bob a little book today on Matthew Henry's life. And then Dan Cameron, as you remember from several months ago, Dan's reading his Bible daily and he's reading a little piece of the commentary daily. What page are you on now, Dan?
903.
Amen. How about that? Isn't that great? So, you know, that's how we grow, through baptizing, through teaching. And as I think about our actions to become disciples, and of course on our minds and hearts is another that has left us to go to heaven. And I'll just begin by mentioning the comment that again Pat Herndon made to me this week. She said, you know, we've lost a lot of people in our church, and it's true, isn't it? It's true. She said, but I'm really happy because I think about all of them gathered in heaven. And Francis, you mentioned dear Jack, you know, and Doris, and now Flora Lee, Cheryl's mama, and Cheryl's here today, and Don Henderson, and you just go on and on and on. And if you picture them together in heaven, that's the truth, is it not? And they are together, and that makes us happy. Even though we're sad here, we're happy as well. And so I particularly think of this one we love so much. This is in loving memory of Flora Lee Blackburn Yarbrough. Some of you were able to come to the funeral, some of you could not. She lived 94 years. And as many of us know, she was such a devoted wife to Mr. Jim Yarbrough. She was such a loving mother to Cheryl and to Stanley and to Leslie. And to fit in with today's message, she was quite a disciple of Christ, a learner, a follower of Flora Lee Yarborough. She was saved here, and she was baptized in July of 1937. Now, if you add all that up, that's like 83 years ago. She's about 11 years old. And I want to show you some of the records that show that special baptismal day. This is out of our book. And here are some of the names. You'll recognize some of these. On that July 24th, 1937 day, one is her brother, Walter Blackburn, baptized that very day. And another is Julia Yarborough. Recognize that name. Another are the Fitches, Jim Fitch, Bonnie Fitch, Helen Fitch. Helen is Ashley Pearson's great-grandmother. And Ashley, you may be listening, your great-grandmother was baptized the same day that Cheryl's mama, Flora, was baptized here. And on that baptismal service went to Ray Barber, John Barber, Howard Randall, DeWitt Randall, Willis Harmon, wow, Ralph Spearman, Hunter Spearman, Aloma Junior Fagans, Ray Blackburn was baptized, and then we get over here and there's Flora Lee Blackburn baptized. And I think, my, what a wonderful, wonderful experience of baptism. So we have that modeled in her life and that foundation. But then also teaching for many years. Just a slice. I didn't have time to go through everything yet, but just a slice of her service, a few snapshots, if you will. From 54 to 58, she taught the primaries, and she taught in the nursery, probably teaching things like God is good, God made the grass, God made the sky, things like that. And then for over 10 years, she taught women ages 25 to 34, teaching them the Bible, teaching them to observe all that Jesus commanded. And then in the 60s and 70s, she's actively involved in GAs. Now, somebody help me out for those that maybe don't know what the G and what does the A stand for. Girls in Action, right? Girls in Action. It's a mission group to teach girls about missions and how to go on mission and to do missions. And Flora was so involved with that during those years. She was a WU president. She was a vice president. And before I get to the last point, I'm just going to throw something out there, and you can fill in the blanks for me. Cheryl, in the last several weeks, I had a great conversation with her mom. She reminisced about the time when there were 6, 7, or 8 women in this church that were pregnant and going to have new babies. I think you were in that group. I think Helen McDaniel and Susie was in that group. Francis was in that group. I mean, I've heard 3 or 4 at a time, but 6, 7, or 8, you're talking about a nursery explosion. Lynn, you might have been in that group too. She was. You know, it's just very unique. Well, Flora told me about all of that, you know, and yet she's one of the ones who taught all those children that were born, certainly many of them in GAs as she served. So she was a great teacher. And then you need to know this, until I check back, till 2015, her name was on our nominating committee list for Homebound, which means she took, and actually Pat Hernan often took her, and they would go visit our shut-ins, and they would visit with them and talk to them and give them the Sunday school lessons and the other literature. And Flora delighted in that. Pat said she really, really enjoyed going to see all the shut-ins. So up until about 90 years old, here's one of our members who is so very active in making disciples. Great example for us, is it not? And let me just say to Cheryl and Stanley and Leslie, we love your family. We loved talking to your mom, being able to converse with her and share with her. I don't know of anyone whose face lit up and smile was as radiant as hers when the Christmas carolers came to sing in these last years. So we remember her today, and I hope the example of her and many, many around us will motivate us to make disciples of all the nations. And as I challenge us as we close out, let us fulfill the Great Commission. Let us fulfill the Great Commission. Let us make disciples, yes, of all the nations, baptizing and teaching them, and let us hold on to that marvelous promise. You can say it with me, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the great commission of your Son, and Lord, for this day where we could revisit what you've charged us to do and to carry out until we are in heaven, worshiping at the feet of Jesus. Give us your grace to do so. May we rely upon the presence of your Son, the Lord Jesus, by his Holy Spirit. And may we realize that all authority has been given to him. And may we here at BBC truly put our heart, may our hearts be full of your power and our lives be full of your energy and activity as we go forward to make disciples. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand as we sing? Lindsay's going to come and lead us, and let us sing together. Singing, and perhaps you've been singing at home, and those very words express your heart. And I encourage you to place your faith in Jesus Christ even now. Turn your eyes to Calvary, and you will be forgiven. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your great grace, for your great salvation. Lord, for anyone listening that they long to be forgiven and to really know you and to be connected with you anew, Lord, I pray that they might place their faith in Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and was raised from the grave to give them life. Thank you that you're willing and ready to save. And Lord, for our dear families that are grieving the loss of those they love around them in the home and here in the church, and for all of us, Lord, comfort our hearts. Comfort Frances, Lord, and all of her family. Comfort Cheryl, Lord, and all of her family. Comfort Eveline and all of her family. And Father, we thank you that there's a day coming when we'll all be together. Comfort dear Danny, Lord, and all of his family, Danny Kaiser. And Lord, fix our eyes on that glorious day when we'll be together in your presence. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel's guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Amen. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today, whether it's here Facebook or later today on Facebook. The sun may not be shining outside, but let the sunshine in your soul shine wherever you go.